because the elected member for Cayman Brac West and Little Cayman.
Let us pray. Almighty God, from whom all wisdom and power are derived, we beseech thee so to direct and prosper the deliberations of the Parliament now assembled, that all things may be ordered upon the best and surest foundations for the glory of thy name and for the safety, honor, and welfare of the people of these islands. Bless our Sovereign Lady, Queen Elizabeth II, Charles, Prince of Wales, and all the royal family. Give grace to all who exercise authority in our Commonwealth, that peace and happiness, truth and justice, religion and piety may be established among us. Especially we pray for the Governor of our islands, the Premier, the Speaker of the Parliament, the Leader of the Opposition, Ministers of the Cabinet, ex officio members, members of the Parliament, the Chief Justice, and members of the Judiciary, that we may be enabled faithfully to perform the responsible duties of our high office. All this we ask for thy great name's sake. Let us say the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless us and keep us. The Lord make his face shine upon us and be gracious unto us. The Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon us and give us peace now and always. Amen.
Please be seated. Proceedings of this Honorable Parliament is now resumed.
Administration of oaths or affirmations?
None.
Reading by the Honorable Speaker of messages and announcements?
None.
Presentation of petitions?
None.
Presentation of papers and of reports?
None.
Questions to honorable ministers and members of the cabinet?
None.
Statements by honorable ministers and members of the cabinet?
We have a statement from the Honorable the Premier. Honorable Premier.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I rise this morning to welcome the honorable member from Bordentown East, Mr. Dwayne Seymour, to the right side of the House, the government bench, this morning. Mr. Speaker, this morning, in accordance with Section 54A1 of the Cayman Islands Constitution Order, His Excellency the Governor has appointed Mr. Seymour, or John, as he is more affectionately known, as Parliamentary Secretary to the Ministry with Responsibility for Labour, as well as, or the Minister with Responsibility for Labour, as well as the Minister with Responsibility for Housing and the Minister with Responsibility for Transport. And Mr. Speaker, I'm sure that more will be put on his plate as this PAC government continues to chart our recovery from the effects of this COVID-19 pandemic and seeks to create further opportunities for shared prosperity and prepares our people to avail themselves of the opportunities which my government seeks to create. Mr. Speaker, this is a proud moment for the PAC government and indeed for the Cayman Islands. The Minister for Planning, Mr. Speaker, called the member for Bordentown East and our newest parliamentary secretary the missing link to the PAC government. I say this is an example of placing the country and our people first as his return to government helps to make a difference in the lives of not only his constituents in Bordentown East, but to Caymanians and the rest of the country as a whole. Mr. Speaker, we warmly welcome him to the fold. He no longer has to be concerned about being like John the Baptist, a voice crying out in the wilderness. His voice, and more importantly, the voice of the people of Bordentown East, whom he proudly represents, will be loudly and clearly heard. I'm especially grateful, Mr. Speaker, that we have united Bordentown. And in fact, all the eastern districts are now represented in this government. Mr. Speaker, I think everyone probably knows, but certainly those people from the eastern side of the island all know how interconnected our needs and issues are. And it goes way beyond electoral boundaries. Mr. Speaker, I and my team look forward to working with the Honourable Member, the newest member of the government, and Parliamentary Secretary, Mr. Duane Seymour. I think he will add to the accomplishments of this government, and he will utilize his experience as a former minister and his experience as a representative otherwise to add significantly to our capacity to deliver on behalf of the people of this country. Mr. Speaker, I thank your good self for joining me and my colleagues last night as we gathered with Mr. Seymour and his constituents to show our support of and respect for our newest member of the PAC government. I reiterate what I said Friday in my budget policy statement. We're here today because the people made a choice in April to elect a government that cares about people, that cares about community, that cares about country. The move by Mr. Seymour, Mr. Speaker, to government strengthens us in our commitment to all of our people and to our country. Mr. Speaker, his inclusion in government will help us as we continue to offer the people leadership to create a more sustainable future for the Cayman Islands that balances the needs of society, the economy, and the environment. And Mr. Speaker, as the Minister for Education said last night at Mr. Seymour's meeting with his constituents, the Cayman Islands needs all hands on deck. So, Mr. Speaker, I am reiterating her call for anyone else on the opposition bench who may wish to join us as we continue to make a real difference in the lives of our people. Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker.
Personal explanations?
Mr. Speaker,
I have been notified by the Honorable, the Leader of the Opposition, that he would want to make a short personal explanation. The Honorable, the Leader of the Opposition.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I appreciate your indulgence with this. Mr. Speaker, when we're here on Monday, you and we're having a discussion, you asked me specifically, had I received the email with regard to the presentation, the budget address, and I indicated to you, no, I hadn't. And Mr. Speaker, I was wrong because it was sent to me on Saturday evening at about 9:20. It was actually sent to my Parliament address, which is one that I do not use. And I just, for the record, wanted to correct it, let members and let the public know that I had, in fact, received it. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. And several of us, I think, that it happens to several of us. I know it happens to me. It goes, mail goes to government, and I don't use government. I use my personal email. And so thank you very much for your explanation. The parliamentary secretary, the member from Bordentown East.
Good morning, Mr. Speaker. I beg your indulgence to respond to Honorable Premier's kind words.
You may.
Thank you so much, Mr. Speaker. Today marks an important milestone in my life as I transition from the opposition of the government bench of this honorable parliament. I am very thankful this morning and want to say good morning to the people of the Cayman Islands and in particular Bordentown East. I also want to say, Mr. Speaker, thank God we survived another hurricane season. It has officially ended, praise God, today being December 1st. Also, please keep in your prayers, Ms. Joanne Frederick, Ms. Mayberry, and Ms. Eula Lee, all seriously ill. Some had to be flown off the island. Let's pray hard. And I remember 1 Thessalonians, Mr. Speaker, 5:16-18. Rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. We are living in a time where a lot is negative, Mr. Speaker, a lot of jealousy, malice, and envy. And us as a nation need to be more appreciative, complimenting, and grateful to each other for where we have come. I want to thank the Honorable Premier for his kind comments this morning, Mr. Speaker. Thank you so much. I can only look around the world and notice what appreciation looks like, what it really looks like, even for those persons who were not born in their lands. We have a lady. Some may know her stage name as Josephine Baker, who was born in America and moved to France at a tender age to become famous and loved by her second home. Many years after, she was given France's highest honor and inducted in the Pantheon and honored as a hero. Or we can look in our region where Prime Minister of Barbados, Honorable Mia Motley, just awarded secular R&B singer Rihanna, who had moved to the United States to become a superstar, was awarded the status of national hero and was told to go shine like a diamond. Ladies and gentlemen, members of Parliament, we have to appreciate all, especially our own, also, and uplift them in any way we can. By way of background, Mr. Speaker, in 2017, the Progressives-led coalition invited me to join their government. But before doing so, I called a public meeting to solicit the advice and support of my constituents in the Bordentown East. Mr. Speaker, as you know, over the past week, members on the government bench, in particular the Honorable Chris Saunders, Deputy Premier, and the Honorable Jay Ebanks, used this forum to publicly call upon me to cross the floor and join the government bench. While this was crafty political maneuvering, it was not a decision that I took lightly, nor one that I was willing to make without first going back to my constituents. As members on both sides of this honorable parliament know, this was not the first overture from the government, but it was the first one in public. As I do with all major decisions, I prayed fervently and sought advice from my committee and a few people who are very close to me. We all agree that this was a decision that ultimately involved my constituents. So just as I did in 2017, I called a special public meeting last night, 30th of November, Mr. Speaker, it is noteworthy that I mentioned that I called every single member on the opposition bench and spoke to them personally about my decision-making process and the fact that I was calling a public meeting. At this meeting, I laid out the facts to my constituents and with the wider country as the meeting was carried live on social media and Radio Cayman. An additional several members of the PAC government spoke to the people of Bordentown East, namely the Honorable Premier Wayne Panton, Deputy Premier Chris Saunders, Honorable Ministers Juliana O'Connor Connolly, Minister Kenneth Bryan, Minister Jay Ebanks, and Parliamentary Secretary and Deputy Speaker, the Honorable Kathy Ebanks-Wilts. Each and every one of them made an impassioned plea and laid out a powerful argument for me to come and join the government's bench. Mr. Speaker, while all of that was flattering and appreciated by me, the final decision was still one that I would only take with the blessings of my constituents, the people of Bordentown East. Mr. Speaker, I can report to this Honorable Parliament that my constituents of Bordentown East in attendance offered unanimous support for me to join the government bench. Further, I can say that I have now received over 200 WhatsApp messages, and all of them, except one, supported me joining the PAC coalition government. Mr. Speaker, that brings to a very important point that I must state for the sake of history and posterity, and that is that I am an independent member of this Parliament. I am not a member of any political party. Mr. Speaker, as I did last night, let me further state for the record my sincere appreciation and gratitude for the opportunity afforded to me, a boy from Gun Square, by the Progressive-led Coalition to have served as Minister in Cabinet from 2017 to 2021. I have forged a lifelong friendship of this, and I thank you all. Today, Mr. Speaker, marks a new journey for me and my people of Bordentown East. Let me say that I am excited to offer my experience to the PAC coalition government and the people of the Cayman Islands. In me, you have got a loyal and experienced member of Parliament and a man who is interested in the good governance of these beloved islands. The election are 7 months removed. It is time to make Cayman the very best for Caymanians to move and have their being. It is time to inspire the next boy or girl from Gun Square to imagine and live all the possibilities our country has to offer. It is time to get on with living with COVID-19. It is time to make education great, to fill the housing gap, to employ all willing and able Caymanians, to solve the traffic nightmares of the eastern districts, to provide the quality health care, to make NAU more accessible to the vulnerable, to ensure no child is hungry in school, you can't learn on a hungry belly, to safely bring back tourists, to ensure the development bank is a tool for progress, to ensure food security, to build sustainability, to ensure Mount Trashmore is a thing of the past, to provide better services to our elderly, to provide more opportunities for budding entrepreneurs. Mr. Speaker, I'm a worker. I have accepted this call to work for the greater good of all Caymanians and proudly represent the Bordentown East District. Mr. Speaker, it is so easy for me to do well because I'm so unassuming and many don't expect much. So my bar is so low that I always overachieve, if I must say. When I was in high school, no one thought I could run, and I ended up being one of the fastest boys on the island. When I was playing with Bordentown Football Club, well, I sat on the bench a lot, and I ended up scoring the winning goal for our first FA Cup of Bordentown. So what I'm saying to you, Mr. Speaker, is that we need to have faith in our people. Just give them a chance. You see, Mr. Speaker, me standing here is not a political strategy. It is not pursuit of power. It is not promotion of self. It is not result of any negotiation. Dwayne Stanley Seymour is standing here to serve the people of Bordentown East, and because of the will of the Almighty God, of reign supreme in the affairs of man, once again I thank my wife, my mother, my entire family, my committee, and the people of Bordentown East, and all well-wishers. Without you all, I cannot do anything. I thank all the persons who messaged and called me to say whatever. Most people, Mr. Speaker, said, whatever you think is best for Bordentown East, I am with you or I support you. Mr. Speaker, these are the people that elect me. They hold my job. I have to listen to them, Mr. Speaker. I thank you all so kindly. I thank all the members of this honorable House, and especially the PAC government for being so receptive. I thank you all, and God bless you.
Obituary and other ceremonial speeches.
None.
Raising of matters of privileges.
None.
Government business, bills, second reading, continuation of debate, appropriation, financial years 2022 and 2023, bill 2021.
Honorable members, on Monday, after the contribution to the debate by the Honorable Minister of Health, I think it was the last speaker at the time, the Honorable Minister of Infrastructure, the member from North Side. I had called the customary three times. And nobody rose. And I want to say that it is not in the standing orders that we call three times. It's a customary thing, a courtesy thing that by the chair, and it's not done in other parliaments. And after calling the third time, I called on the mover to close the debate. The member for Georgetown North, I think, rose, but I still did not see him, but I gathered that he had risen after I had called, and while the member for Georgetown, for Bordentown West, the deputy premier, was on his feet. And I said in the members' room that I would not be calling beyond the three times, as I had in this debate called four times. I can't go beyond that, honorable members, because then the speaker would seem to be begging members to, in parliamentary terms, that's what it's used to. The speaker cannot beg members to speak. It's members' duty and preference if they want to speak. I've been in government, I've been in opposition, and I know what the waiting game is. And no member needs to try to fool this speaker. Can I just come here? I understand the waiting game, but you gotta be smart with it. If you wait too long, then you outwit yourself. And so, I spoke to members that I can't go beyond the three times, and I won't. The deputy premier graciously gave way and said he would allow the member for Georgetown North to speak. That's the member's prerogative that this chair can accept. And at the same time, the member for Georgetown North was moving out of the chamber. Honorable members, That invitation stands for any member at this time. Once it opened, it opened. And so I hereby call, does any other member wish to speak? The member for Georgetown North.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I can assure you I was not playing, or assure this House I was not playing games on Monday evening. Perhaps a little slow to my feet, but I was not. I was actually quite pleased that several of the ministers, in particular, the first-time ministers, actually spoke, and spoke very well, if I must say so, on their plans for the upcoming 2 years. I spoke to some of them after we almost shut down the House at lunch and said to them, don't let this opportunity escape you. When I look back, it was one of my proudest moments, was my first budget debate as a minister, and I would hate to have seen it escape them as well. It is something that you'll look back with and keep for prosperity. There's YouTube videos of it. You have your transcripts. These are things that their children will look at, their family will look at over and over and over again. And so I was very happy. And they can attest that I did speak to several of them individually to say, do not allow this moment to pass you. Mr. Speaker, I also want to congratulate the member from Bordentown East and wish him well as he joins the ranks of the government. That, I guess, fills all the seats and completes a united democratic pact. Short UDP. I want to also take this opportunity, Mr. Speaker, to thank the governor for the throne speech, for his throne speech, and for his continued support and often over and above support to our islands and its people. Mr. Speaker, I was eagerly anticipating what is usually an exciting and inspirational budget and policy statement. However, I felt that what was delivered by the Premier on Friday was far from that. But rather, the Premier painted a picture of doom and gloom with a promise of hope. I was happy, however, to hear a slightly different tone from the Minister of Finance, who spoke of building on foundations. It reminded me, Mr. Speaker, I know you often said that I skipped Sunday school, but it reminded me of a song about a wise man building his house upon the rocks. And I'm glad that the Honorable Minister of Finance and Deputy Premier saw the wisdom, or perhaps he too remembered the song, and will build upon the solid foundation that this administration left behind. However, Mr. Speaker, I do share some concerns, those echoed by the leader of the opposition, in particular that on the level of borrowing. Mr. Speaker, the Honorable Premier stated in his contribution that many hard-working business owners and employees found themselves one medical bill or one paycheck away from financial ruin. Mr. Speaker, I am concerned that this near $1 billion budget, this $350 million borrowing, with a mere $8.5 million surplus in 2023, is, Mr. Speaker, exactly what the Premier described as being one medical bill or one paycheck away from financial ruin. Mr. Speaker, I pray that the government reconsiders this open checkbook policy. And I don't, and just don't disregard us and say, I've got this. Because if you don't, Mr. Speaker, if they don't, our children and our grandchildren will have it. That is the financial burden of the borrowing. Mr. Speaker, that is almost $12,000 per a person. Yes, that is what 350 million divided amongst 30,000 Caymanians equals. During the last period, when our administration boasted large surpluses, there were calls from the opposition. Why are we holding on to the people's money? Spend it on them. I heard it several times. Our response always was that you have to save for a rainy day. And may I say, Mr. Speaker, and as the Premier said, COVID-19 was a Cat 5, not just a rainy day. I pray that this is not the philosophy of this government, Mr. Speaker. It sounds good, but it is killing the goose for the golden egg. I pray daily that this is not the case. But, Mr. Speaker, I do believe we have a lot more rainy days ahead of us. New COVID variants, increased costs in shipping, which we are heavily dependent upon, food shortages, meaning increased costs, increased fuel prices, meaning increased utility bills, shortage of vehicles around the world, which means harder for persons to attain transportation. This is where we need to be focusing, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I also want to take this opportunity to clarify some comments made by the Honorable Premier. When he made mention of the LCCLs, or now called the LCCA, Local Company Control Act, waivers being the norm. Mr. Speaker, the Honorable Premier was a minister responsible for the Trade and Business License, or the Department of Commerce and Investment, from 2013 to 2017, and he did a fantastic job. I remember sitting as a member of the caucus and as a councillor back then, but is now a parliamentary secretary, debating the waiver of an LCCL for contracts to build the airport. Our government, under the advice of the now premier, decided that we would not, and some counseling, decided that we could not waive, or we would not waive the LCCL for that company to operate at the airport. What we did decide is that we would waive advertisement for Caymanian participation. That was a policy moving forward. Mr. Speaker, that policy continued to waive advertisement for publicly traded companies, for example, some vehicles that were operated by the banks to move funding, or perhaps family practices where it would be impossible to have a local partner. That was a policy that continued under my 4 years. I am not aware of any waivers of LCCLs. Mr. Speaker, I will say that some of the policies created under the Honorable Premier and the 2013 to 2017 progressive-led government served us very well. I continued the incentives started under his watch, as he said, building on foundations. And I took it a step further, Mr. Speaker, removing almost 60% of the red tape. And I hope that it doesn't creep back for Caymanians to receive a trade and business license. We went 100% online. Mr. Speaker, these efforts saw an increase in trade and business licenses for Caymanians. In 2020, we saw an increase of 23% over 2019. Mr. Speaker, that was an increase of some 605 trade and business license applications. In the height of the pandemic, some 600 new applications were received between March 21st and June 17th, 2020, showing a very strong local economy and removing barriers for Caymanians to live the dream of owning their own business. And moving on, Mr. Speaker, I am happy that the government will continue with the UK-Cayman Climate Change Environment Partnership Agreement, which I announced in November 2020 at the Caribbean Transitional Energy Conference, which was held virtually. I also urge the Honorable Premier not to discard all of the hard work and efforts made by the team at the Department of Planning on the Plan Cayman initiative. I understand and I know that the Premier is determined to review the national planning law for all three islands. Mr. Speaker, many ministers before me and ministers before him have tried that since 1997, and each have failed. We came up with an idea to review five, to break the island up into five sections, Grand Cayman into five sections, and review one section a year, revolving, therefore being in compliance with the law and reviewing the entire Grand Cayman every 5 years. Staff in the department put in a lot of work and a lot of time, and the foundation is there. It was a political campaign tool against me, saying that it was designed for the developers, but the plan was not complete. Just an outline case, just a base document. It is ready to go to public consultation. It is ready to move, and I encourage and urge the Honorable Premier and the government not to just disregard all of the hard work, but to have a look at it closely. Mr. Speaker, I want to touch on a few areas, one being the Georgetown revitalization. I'm happy to see funding in there again. There was a lot of grunt work, if you want to call it that, or underground work or base work done. A lot of drawings, designs, things like the entire Georgetown, center of Georgetown, all of the utilities have now been mapped. So we know where every wire, every line, every light pole, every water pipe, everything is around the town. That took a long time and a lot of money. There was a lot of work put into the Georgetown revitalization that got us to this point, and I'm happy to see funding in the budget, and I look forward to hearing more about what the plans are. I am happy to also hear the planning minister intends to remove some of the red tape from planning. I wish for him all the success, and I assume he has the Honorable Deputy Governor behind him, perhaps, and it seems as if he may need the Honorable AG, as he has a few lawsuits being filed against the CPA, but perhaps he will be conflicted in those, since those lawsuits are from government agencies as well. But I do wish the member all the best in continuing to streamline and continuing to create efficiencies within the CPA and, in particular, the planning department. And again, if there's any help I can give to him, I'm happy to do so. I want to also thank the minister for continuing some of the projects on the road work projects that were started under my administration. I won't go into the details of them. It's not about who's doing them. I think these are one of these things that we all sit in traffic, we all suffer from it, and we all want to see it resolved. I would only encourage the minister to continue to fight for the complete streets philosophy, or the shared streets where you can. If we are going to lower our carbon footprint, if we are going to reduce traffic, it can't be just from building roads. We have to encourage and make it safe for persons to use bicycles, scooters, or walk, or jog and exercise if we want to keep COVID away as well. It is the future. All of the hotels have put bicycles outside for their guests to ride. There are two scooter companies on the island that you can pick up a scooter anywhere, and I see people using them, but some of our roads are just outright dangerous for it. Between potholes that people, I've known a couple of people that have wiped out on the scooters from hitting potholes, but between potholes and no shoulder space or no bike lanes and no traffic calming devices, in particular along the 7 Mile Beach corridor where we have heavy foot traffic, heavy bicycle traffic, people exercising, people using the scooters for transportation. And again, like I said, I do believe if we saw during the lockdown when there were no cars on the road, there might have people exercising. I often jog, well, before I broke my ankle, I would jog along the West Bay Road, and it actually got frustrating. There were so many people jogging, you had more traffic jogging than you did driving. But we have to create the environment for people to A, be healthy, get out there, ride a bicycle, run, walk, and B, create the environment for persons to choose alternative forms of transportation. And that is the shared road, if not possible, to do the complete streets. Again, I offer my full support to the minister on that. I also want to congratulate the minister on the 33 new apprenticeships in the Public Works Apprenticeship Program, which can now house 33 because of the purpose-built building that was built under my time as a minister responsible for public works. I heard the minister when he spoke about perhaps expanding or perhaps changing the program a bit. I will say this to the minister, and I'll say it publicly. The key to the success to that program are the amazing mentors that mentor the young men and women at the Public Works program. Do not remove that. Many would not show up, many of the students would not show up if not for some of the mentors going to their house and saying, put your clothes on, let's go. That is a fact. So please do not move away from that. That is the key, that is the success, the key to the success of that program is the encouragement, the mentorship that's offered to those young men and women by senior members of the Public Works Department. Mr. Speaker, I'm happy that the reduction in fees for driver's license, renewals, et cetera, at the Department of Department of Vehicle and Driver's License, one thing you will all learn is that you're gonna start speaking in acronyms and forget names. But I'm happy to see that it has finally made its way through the cabinet, and that, Mr. Speaker, as you would know, was a part of our elderly persons policy that was created by this administration as well. Let us continue to support that policy. Let us continue to push for changes, for a new regime for our elderly. They deserve it. They deserve the respect, they deserve all the help that they can get, and they have done their role, they have done their part in building this amazing country, so let us do our role, let us do our part in supporting them. Mr. Speaker, I also want to congratulate the ministry, and the department for their transition to the online platform. It has been difficult. There were many, many obstacles in their way that were outside of their control, including the ability to get proper service to the department. But I am happy to know that it is moving forward and that they have had some successes there. And I would like to congratulate all involved for continuing that program and for realizing some successes. I also want to congratulate the ministry on continuing with phase two of the Department of Vehicle and Equipment Services. State of the art, dry, safe, facilities that are worthy of human beings working in. The first phase, which we completed during my tenure, was the stores and the administration block. Mr. Speaker, the Honorable Premier quite often teased me about my height, but when I went into that administration building on my tour, I had to duck down to go through some of the rooms. I don't know how those folks worked in those conditions for so long. But again, I thank the Minister for continuing. Now I see that the progress which started with us and continues on, and I hope it continues into phase three. The bays for the large vehicles, I think for the electric vehicles are just about almost completed, it looks like. And congratulations to all who were involved in those as well. And so, Mr. Speaker, all that I just said, I want to congratulate the minister for following the Sunday school song and continuing to build on a strong foundation, not on the sand, but on the rock. Mr. Speaker, near and dear to me, and I hope that perhaps the minister will get up and speak, or perhaps we'll hear more during the committee stages, is a small business development center. I hope it continues to do what it was developed for. I spoke to some of the, I keep in touch with some of the clients in the incubator / accelerator program. Fantastic stories of success there. I hope the government sees the ROI in it. A lot of talk about investing in people, and I think this certainly fits the old adage of don't give a man a fish, but teach a man to fish, and you'll feed him forever. I do not want, and I hope, and I understand the role that the Small Business Development Center plays, or the Cayman Islands Center for Business Development plays in this pandemic, but I do not, and I wish not, that that center just becomes an ATM dispensing money. Also, Mr. Speaker, I want to congratulate the government for continuing the digital ID program. This is a tremendous step. If we had had the digital IDs in place when the pandemic hit us, it would have made so many things easier. And that is what drove me to really push to try and get the digital IDs in place. It's not something that you can go put your name on a plaque and put it up on the wall to say you did it, but it's something that's important for the future of this country. And not just for the government, but also for the economy. It is the foundation and the first step for digitalizing our economy and for assisting the financial sector. And hopefully one day, I went to the lawyers yesterday to sign some documents for our businesses. Hopefully one day, along with these wonderful papers here, everything will be digital and we won't have to chop down so many trees just to change a name or something on a document. But that is the modality that we have to adopt. If we are going to stay leaders in the world, we have got to get up to speed, and I hope and I wish that the government keeps this at pace, but also continue to pressure the financial institutions to get their infrastructure and to invest in their systems so that when we are ready to launch, we can see the real benefits of the digital ID program. The submarine cable, Mr. Speaker, fits right in with that. And I want to congratulate members of the Special Economic Advisory Council that I formed during the pandemic for the hard work that they put in and the research that they put in, many of hours at a time when they could have been busy doing other things. Volunteers have supported and provided help in getting us to where we were with the submarine cable. And one young man in the government who came out when he didn't have to, Mr. Miguel Jakes, I want to congratulate him in, as I see some RFPs going out, in getting to this stage. I hope he's still involved. I hope he receives the support that he deserves. and I want to congratulate him on his vision and his work that he put in on this submarine cable. Mr. Speaker, I am also extremely happy to hear the Minister of Tourism supporting many of the hotel projects that started under my term. In fact, the Minister of Finance named the very same projects as key contributors to the finances of this government and its ambitious agenda. I, along with many in the community, felt a real fear and concern that the PAC government intended to put a halt to such development. But I guess, Mr. Speaker, it became clear the importance of the jobs that these developments provide, the importance of the revenue that these developments will contribute to the government coffers in order for us to build community centers, in order for us to build parks, in order for us to protect lands. Mr. Speaker, in closing, I want to say that yes, I am the Deputy Leader of the Opposition. And yes, I am, I guess, a politician. And yes, Mr. Speaker, I'm a representative of the people, but I'm also a Caymanian with family, children, hopefully one day with grandchildren, with businesses. I am personally, Mr. Speaker, and financially invested in this country. And so, Mr. Speaker, it is important not just for me in my capacity as a member of this parliament, for this government to succeed, but it is important for my family, for my children, my grandchildren in the future, for my businesses. And so I urge the government to do as the governor said, to proceed with prudence and caution so that we, not we, our children and our grandchildren will not be saddled with the burdens and the debt of our decisions. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Does any other member wish to speak? The member for Georgetown West caught my eye first. Member for Georgetown West.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Anything formed through hatred or revenge will never be successful. Mr. Speaker, I rise to make a short contribution to the budget debate, but I will take a different approach. Mr. Speaker, before I start, there's something on my mind that's been bothering me, and I think we need an explanation. And there's no blaming or any fault of anyone because I don't know. I just need to find out where the problem lies and see if we can solve this problem. But in doing so, I just want to say that I have never been anyone who will boast of their achievements, my personal achievements. I will never brag. But in laying out what I want to say, I have to list a few accomplishments that I have done. And this is involving sports. As everyone knows, our family has been heavily involved in sports over the years. We have been especially involved in cricket, and this goes back deeply because my grandfather, my father's father, was selected to represent the West Indies cricket team on the 1930 31 tour of Australia that passed on through our father into his children. He formed the Byright Sports Club, and proudly I have to admit that the Byright cricket team became one of Cayman's most successful sports teams. We went 19 years as champions, and we were undefeated in those 19 years, for 15 years. The police team of the 70s were always our arch enemy, and they were what drove us to what we were, what we became. Mr. Speaker, on a personal note, and this is what I'm saying about listing a few achievements. My brother, Christopher, and I, we played, and the AG would know about this, we played for a top Jamaica Senior Cup team, Melbourne Cricket Club, in the 90s. Christopher and I went away as semi-pros in the Central Lancashire League and the Lancashire League. We had the cricket crazy weekend here in Cayman, and they were all personal achievements and great memories, and they meant a lot to us personally. But Mr. Speaker, our greatest achievements were when we were representing Cayman in any tournament. That's when we had our national pride, and that's what we look forward to. We did well locally, and when we were playing for Byright, our father, he rewarded us with trips overseas, and that was our only chance to get some overseas competition. Your driver, when I say that we were involved in all types of sports, your driver, Mr. Graham Rankin, he always comes to us and asks us to look, he wants us to push our brother Michael to get some award, because Michael is the only person in Cayman that has represented Cayman in 5 different sports. We were involved in all sports. Mr. Speaker, as I said, we only played locally, and we enjoyed cricket and we loved cricket, and it was through the passion of cricket that we were involved with Byright. In 1997, we hired a technical director to try take cricket to another level, Mr. Theo Cuffey. In 1998, we were awarded affiliate status by the ICC. In 2002, we were awarded associate status by the ICC. This allowed us to get funding from ICC, which we developed, which we put towards developing cricket in the schools, and a lot of praise has to go to Mr. Andy Miles, Kisco, for what he did in the schools. Through him, we were able to develop a youth program that forwarded cricketers into the national team. And that's where everybody's ambition is, to play for the national team. Mr. Speaker, from 1998, when we represented Cayman as an affiliate country, and then in 2002 as an associate country, we have, as a country, we have been involved in every ICC Americas tournament until this year. 2 weeks ago, a tournament just finished in Antigua. The regular 5 countries, USA, Canada, Bermuda, Argentina, and Bahamas were there. Cayman was missing, but they had 2 new countries, Belize and Panama. If those countries could go and perform in Antigua, why wasn't Cayman there? When you miss a tournament, an ICC-sanctioned tournament, you will always have problems getting invited again. We missed this tournament. As I said, we as young players look forward to playing for the national team. What do the people know if we don't have this chance to represent Cayman in these ICC tournaments? What do they have to look forward to? And this is worrying because we've been receiving calls from cricketers. We've had visits from cricketers that are very concerned. And also, I know the coach, the former coach, Christopher and I, we made friends over the years with people from Bermuda, Canada, USA, who we played against. We got calls from them asking, how isn't Cayman represented at this tournament? And I'm not blaming anybody because we've tried to find what the problem is and we're getting run around and we're getting different answers everywhere we go. So I'm putting it out there. We want to save cricket for the younger generation coming up and don't make Kisco and the Miles' hard work go in vain. So I'm just asking if we can find a way of finding out what stopped this from taking place. I will move on, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, 4.5 years ago, just over 4.5 years ago, I was approached by the progressives who asked me to stand as their candidate for the District of Georgetown West. Through all my involvement with politics, I had never really had an interest to put myself forward as a candidate, but rather I would actively support candidates who I believed in and trusted. I consulted my family and close friends to seriously consider all the implications of putting myself forward. It would be a great challenge and would bring big responsibilities. But we agreed that if I received those I get criticized and I would receive them anyway if I was elected. So the main thing that came out of when I met with them was that if I remained strong to myself, I remained honest, they would back me and support me 100%. If I believe in something and no one has been able to show me that I am wrong, I can only stand up for my belief. By speaking out honestly on what I believe and not being hypocritical in my positions, my family and close friends will continue to trust in me and support me in any way they can. Some people may even disagree with some of my positions or things I may say, but they know I take these positions and say these things because that is what I believe and stand for. All agreed that as long as I continue to stand for what I believe in, they will support me 100%. They know that I'm not acting with any ulterior motive, and they are able to trust that my stance is not based on any hypocritical reasons and is only based on my honest belief of any situation. Mr. Speaker, I did not run to make any decision to become popular. If I did what I did and somebody didn't like me, it's no problem. But I wasn't going to compromise myself and my belief to do something to make anybody like me. I'm proud to say that my family and close friends have supported me 100%, and I still ask and receive important feedback when I'm making big decisions. Mr. Speaker, I was successful in my first attempt as candidate for Georgetown West and was successful when I stood for re-election. I believe and hope that this is largely because the people of Georgetown West know that I will never be hypocritical in an attempt to gain power, and they can trust the positions I take are based on my honest understanding of any position. I understand that being an elected member of parliament means that there will have to be some level of compromise on issues for the good of the country, but I will never compromise who I am and the principles I live by. Mr. Speaker, from just prior to the 1984 elections, I had been deeply involved in Cayman politics. My parents raised me to care and take an interest in our community and always try and do something about issues we saw. Many members of this honorable chamber know that over the years, I've always stood for and spoken out for what I believed in, and in many cases, this was to the detriment of me and my family. Christopher and I were known to get on the radio show to speak our minds on issues we were concerned about. Over the years, I've spoken out against some of the positions taken by members of this honorable parliament and criticized political actions of those I had disagreed with. Many times this brought criticism and disagreement on me, and sometimes this became very heated. While I will never claim that my positions and beliefs are always right, I will always stand for my right to hold and speak these beliefs. Fear that I might possibly be wrong does not stop me from holding and putting forward my positions, and I accept I must bear the disagreement from others and sometimes be corrected. But I believe that by airing my concerns, I give everyone the opportunity to give their positions on the topics that leads to a more knowledgeable community. It was an honor to be elected and then re-elected to serve my constituents in Parliament. It was also an honor to be appointed as councillor to two ministries over my first term. It was a humbling and educating experience because it gave me insight into what it takes to run a country. The budget process, Mr. Speaker, was one of the most important and difficult tasks we were involved in. It was amazing to see how much hard work and thought is put into this important function. As a councillor for two ministries, I saw what it took to prepare our part of the budget for the country. I stand here to say that all of Cayman should be proud of the civil servants and the hard work and honesty they bring to the process. Each ministry presents its plans and requirements for the coming 2 years. The financial secretary and his team sit in on these presentations, and each request for funding has to be negotiated with the larger available budget for the country. It is not possible to grant every request, and each item has to be justified based on the need and the cost. This whole process is based on each party having full trust in trying to do what is best for the country and Caymanian people. I know that I feel, this is my view, is that the Premier, he has the final say after getting all the input from government members and the financial secretary and so on. And our Premier wouldn't just jump off and make any decision. He'll go along with what we suggest and what he feels is best. Ultimately, as I said, the Premier had the final say after all the discussions. Why this worked was because we all had a deep trust that our Premier and all those involved in the negotiations were doing so with the honest intention of doing what was best for Cayman. Mr. Speaker, over the years, I have criticized many politicians, campaigned against many politicians, and have been criticized by many more. I've been part of parties where I supported politicians and eventually ended up campaigning against them. In a lot of cases, I've campaigned against politicians and ended up supporting them. Mr. Speaker, everybody knows how I campaigned against you for many years. I campaigned against you, I criticized you. And Mr. Speaker, I ended up working with you. But I'm going to tell you, Mr. Speaker, I have never, in all the years that I criticized you and criticized former members of government, I have never, Mr. Speaker, said I would never work with you. I never did say that. I criticized you, I campaigned against you, but I never came out and said I would never work with you. 2017, when I saw what the government wanted to do, and you were going to become Speaker, I went along with it. I was not... Mr. Speaker, Christopher and I have been blamed for many things, some of which we were not responsible for. But through it all, I felt the need to speak on issues both and for and against when I felt the need. I feel the need now, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I'm going to tell you, being on the opposition is no problem for me. I'm honored to be elected. I'm honored to serve my people of Georgetown West, and I think they're happy with me being their member in Parliament. They re-elected me. But Mr. Speaker, if I don't trust somebody, that is bad. If somebody gives me their word and they break it, I'm sorry, I can't take your word again. Mr. Speaker, I stood in a room after the 2021 elections, and I was given the word three times, you have my word. Three times, you have my word. That word was broken by the morning. I don't know how I can really trust, and I'll get to my trust part, and that's why I'm having an issue with the budget. I know there are members of our government, and I've looked through it, and there are good things in this budget. But promises were made before. Mr. Speaker, that's just a trust issue. We had somebody, a member who was on their way to come to us, was sidetracked. And for some reason, after making promises to his people and different ones, he ended up somewhere else. That is politics. That's politics. You know, that happens. I lose trust, but that's politics. Mr. Speaker, my problem is I was raised in a very strict Christian family. I was we were warned against hypocrites. That's one of the main things. I can't trust a hypocrite. I mean, I don't want to go into it too much, but to be somewhere where there's a hypocrite, it gets to me that I'm afraid. You don't know what they're going to do behind your back. Mr. Speaker, I just want to say, oh boy. Mr. Speaker, there was a member, I sat in that on government for 4 years. There was a member who was there with us. I remember the derogatory words. I spent 4 years being insulted. He does it as a joke, but it gets to you. I spent 4 years being told that I am eating my own vomit. My parents are turning in their grave because I was working with you. It gets to you when you go to, I represented the Minister for Education now, when she was sports minister, I would go to functions and football programs, and we had foreign dignitaries come to Cayman, and I'm there, and I'm being told that I'm eating my vomit, and my parents are turning in their grave, and it gets to me. But that is not hypocritical. What is hypocritical? And this is the thing that I can't take. And I know they've noticed a change in me. But when a man or somebody can leave government, say the very derogatory, nasty sayings about you, they refuse to work in a government that has so-and-so and so as a speaker. Mr. Speaker, just a few months later, the member is over there on government with you in the same position. Speaker, how can I believe anything more? Mr. Speaker, reawakening, okay. But still, my trust and my belief in what they are putting forward, Mr. Speaker, my mouth is getting a little dry. Mr. Speaker, when you came back as the Speaker when we were government, a motion was brought to this House, Mr. Speaker. It was seconded by a member from the present government. It was seconded by him, wanted to get rid of you. Leading up to the elections, this same member got on a TV talk show, and I still got it on my phone, when asked if he would form a government with you. I can answer that. Absolutely not. I might have been campaigning against you. I was never hypocritical with what I did. I never did say I wouldn't work with you. But the most hurtful one, because I expected better, is when you came back, Mr. Speaker, as Speaker of this House, there were two members of Progressive. You know, they resigned from the Progressive Party. There was a Progressive office in Bordentown or up by Countryside. The Progressive sign was torn down and a sign was put up. She is supported. And you see, this is the part that really hurt me. Leading up to the elections, one of those members said, and I have it recorded because I keep those, when asked if they would form a government with you, oh no, it's against my morals and my integrity. I would never do that. Well, I am totally disappointed because now I'm hearing that there's no morals and no integrity. Mr. Speaker, I just had to get that off my chest because I know they have seen a difference in me because I can't take hypocrites. And if you're going to campaign, and Mr. Speaker, I can look at it, and this is my belief. Nobody can take my belief from me. In the lead up and all the campaigning that going on to the elections, when these people were saying they would not form a government with you, how do we know that they weren't elected by the people who had that in mind that they would not be working with you. And it's not a slight against you, Mr. Speaker. I'm only talking about who said they would not work with you. And they campaigned on that, right? A month later, they are sitting in government with you as Speaker. So when they're going to tell me now that they have this great budget for the people, and I know that we have some members, and I've looked over it, they have good points, but they can say anything, they can promise anything. Promises were broken before leading up to the elections. How do I know that this budget that promised to the people will be delivered by that government who has previously broken promises? Anyway, I just had to get that off my chest because that is really hurting me, Mr. Speaker.
And you know that there were those on your side that said they were not working with me, yet they were prepared to form the government with me when they couldn't get a government form. You know that, right?
They were prepared to form a government with you?
Yep.
So where are we now?
In the opposition.
Okay.
Because I didn't join. I just want to clarify something.
No, but I don't know that. And let me tell you something.
You didn't know?
No. And Mr. Speaker, can I be honest with you? If I know that a member is saying that they would never work with you and turn around and form a government with you, I don't care what they say. If they say, oh, I'll form a government with him. But if they turn around and did it, I cut them off. It's simple as that. That's my belief, and nobody can take that from me. I did not know, and I see them over here, and I haven't seen a government form with anybody from our side. So thank you, Mr. Speaker.
I think yes, I'm going to ask you to move on.
Yeah, I am moving on.
Moving on because yeah. I am tempted to answer you.
Okay.
And since it's about me,
no,
perhaps
Mr.
I will
Speaker,
do so at another time.
Mr. Speaker, you see, you're getting that wrong. This is nothing concerning you. You ran in the elections. You were elected. You were duly elected by the people, right? You don't have a problem with that. They put your name forward as Speaker. You have every right to accept it. I'm talking about the people who campaigned that they would not speak with, I mean, form a government with you. That's where my concern is.
I understand, member. You put it well. I just want to make you know that there were those on your side who said they would not work with me. And if I had joined you, then they would be working with me.
I understand what you're saying. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, there are some who are proclaiming that this government has done a good job in handling the COVID pandemic in Cayman. How can going from zero to over 4,000 cases in a few months before borders were even open be considered a success? While I do not claim to be a scientist, or have all the answers, I did witness the incredible hard work the government of unity, together with our civil servants, put into successfully managing the COVID pandemic. I know we made the best interests of the Caymanian people our top priority and made the difficult decisions, even if they were not the most popular at the time. I believe that because of how we successfully managed the country over the previous years, the people trusted us, and as a result, they played their part in successfully stopping the spread of COVID in our community. We had a plan to move to the next stage of safely reopening our borders. As I said, Mr. Speaker, I do not... Sorry, it's a fop in my ear. I mean, a fly in my ear. Sorry. As I said, I do not claim to be a scientist or have all the answers, but I will say what I believe. I believe that the change in quarantine time to 5 days was one of the major factors for COVID spreading as fast as it has done. 5 days has no basis in science. We always understood that it could take between 10 to 14 days for the virus to show up after you have been infected. It would have been better for this government to have changed the quarantine rules to zero time and told the people that they would now be at risk from anyone entering our country who might have COVID. In doing that, and that's just a little extreme, in doing that, the people would know they had to protect themselves and take all precautions, very similar to where we are now. Government should have mounted an educational drive prior to taking that decision to let all the population know how to protect themselves and what precautions to take. They could have been honest with the people in letting them know that they would be at risk. We would then have known to take precautions. We all knew and understand that Cayman has to open its borders as soon as possible, and I think we understood there would be some spread when we did that. But to put us in a position where we continue to believe our government was doing what was right for us and trust in their decisions left us vulnerable and exposed to the spread of COVID. And that is what has happened. To go from the CDC rating for Cayman as a level 3 low risk country for COVID to being rated at level 4 very high risk in a matter of months is not good management of the pandemic. What is worse is this put the health and welfare of Caymanians at risk. So I do not agree that this government has done a good job of managing the pandemic. Mr. Speaker, how can we trust this government to be making right decisions and policies in the future? In finishing, Mr. Speaker, Premier Panton used a lot of words in his presentation in this budget session. That is his profession, and I'm sure he's good at it. But I'm concerned when it seems someone is trying to put labels on things. During the progressive time in government, our prime focus was on making things better for all Caymanians. Not my people, but all Caymanians. With an emphasis on trying to provide help for any that needed help. We did not try to place people in certain categories. We definitely did not operate our government under the guise of trickle-down economics. Our focus was simply to provide the best economic environment for all Caymanians. Mr. Panton now says he is pursuing a middle-out policy. The danger is that they will be focusing on one segment of our community, one segment of our economy, possibly to the detriment of other segments. I agree to help those within our society that need help, but to limit that help to a particular segment is not right. Putting labels on segments of our society will also have unintended consequences of beginning to form a class of warfare where one segment is played off the other for political gain. We have seen this play out in countries across the world, and it only tears apart those communities. Mr. Speaker, a successful government needs its people to trust in what they are doing. Some may not agree with my position, but I have to say what I believe. Given all that has taken place, how can I or the Caymanian people have trust that this government is doing and will do what is best for Cayman and all Caymanians? Time will tell, but at this stage, they will have to work hard to earn our trust and confidence. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Does any other member wish to speak? The member for Georgetown South.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, before I deliver my contribution, I would like to thank the Honorable Premier and his PAC government for the kind invitation to join them on that side. But I just want them to know that I'm quite happy out here on this side with my official opposition. But thank you for the invitation in any event. Moving on to my speech. Mr. Speaker, I rise to deliver my contribution to the 2022-2023 budget address and throne speech. My contribution will focus on education and social development. First, I will speak to education. As my colleague, the Leader of the Opposition, said in his speech in response to the Premier's address to the House, we are reassured that education has continued as a top priority for his PAC government. We have taken comfort from the reappointment of the Honourable Minister for Education. The Honourable Premier, when he made that appointment, suggested it was an important signal of continuity, and the actions that she has put in place since are a clear continuation of the policy agenda that she and I were working on through the last administration. It is vital that this continuity remains, Mr. Speaker. We cannot return to the stop-start changes in policy direction that have marked previous transitions to a new government. All that has done is to condemn successive groups of students to suffer while abrupt switches in direction were implemented. The country needs to maintain continuity in education policy because that policy has seen improvement begin to take roots across Cayman's public schools. The first Progressives-led government of 2013 to 2017 did the groundwork. It carried out baseline assessments of our schools and modernized the restrictive legislative framework that was holding back change. It began the improvement journey that the Honourable Minister continued so ably during the 2017-2021 administration. The Minister delivered the introduction of the modern curriculum that challenges our students to achieve. She oversaw investment in improving the quality of teaching that lies at the heart of raising standards. She laid the groundwork for a new model of school governance and local accountability that will support future improvement. She led the delivery of the new John Gray High School campus and expansion to the classroom and sports facilities across the primary school estate. And most importantly, as part of the last Progressives-led government, Mr. Speaker, the Minister demonstrated that real improvement could be delivered in Cayman's public schools. The last round of public school inspections carried out as we left office found improvement in all three of Cayman's high schools, with two of them, John Gray and Lehman Scott, now being rated as good. That is the minimum standard we should expect of all of our public schools. The progress achieved to date shows that with continued support from the ministry, and more importantly, continued determination an effort by those teaching on the front line. It is a standard we can achieve. But our ambition and plans when in government were to go beyond good to excellent. Mrs. Speaker, we have heard both the Premier and the Finance Minister say promising words about their continued commitment to education and the future success of our young people. As I say, I appreciate that and commend them. I hope and trust that they will provide their full support to the Minister so that she can continue with the successful programs begun when the Minister was the Progressives Minister of Education. At the last election, we on this side of the House were proud to put before the country a track record that we knew created a platform for future success. Therefore, we were able to make a very specific pledge to the country at the election that all public schools would be good or better by the end of this term. Mr. Speaker, we knew it was ambitious, but achievable. The Minister and I both stood behind that pledge in April when we campaigned together. That must be the minimum ambition that the government should aim for. And as I have said, our ultimate ambition was to move from great to excellent. The platform is firmly in place. The government is saying the right things, but ultimately, the country needs to see achievement, not just hear warm words. Is the PAC government willing to match the ambition and the determination that we on this side have and give a specific pledge that all public schools will be rated good or better by the end of their term in office? I hope they are willing to make that pledge. More than that, Mr. Speaker, I hope they are willing to display the fortitude necessary to deliver on it. As the Leader of the Opposition said earlier in the debate, Mr. Speaker, the government can count on our support as it pursues the continuation of the policies we established, particularly as regards to education. For example, Mr. Speaker, I welcomed from the outset the enhancements that the Minister announced to the various scholarship programs that support Caymanian students in their progression and for which funds are provided in this budget. With an eye to the future of education, the increases in funding available as education teaching scholarships to those wishing to pursue teaching qualifications is particularly important. Improving the quality of teaching is the most important contributor to raising standards in education. That starts with being able to attract the best and brightest of our young Caymanian talent into the teaching profession. The scholarship funding increases are a welcome initiative in moving us in that direction, and I thank the Minister for continuing the policy direction that we worked on together over the last 4 years in that respect. That support we offered the Minister will not, however, be unthinking and therefore may not be uncritical. Even where we share the same objectives, we may disagree on the details of how to get there. Therefore, as we go through the detailed budgets in Finance Committee, I will clearly point out any areas in which this PAC government is falling short or where we believe there are better ways to achieve our common goals. One such area, Mr. Speaker, is the free school meals policy. Again, this was something we were working on towards the end of the last administration, and I support the declared intent of ensuring that students in public schools benefit from the nutrition that can support effective learning. My concern is with the universal provision of meals that the government has embarked upon. But I will say more about that when we get to the appropriate budget line in Finance Committee and the details are more available. For now, Mr. Speaker, I want to raise three more strategic concerns that do not fall neatly into budget lines for debate in committee. Each is highly significant if we are to push forward towards the successful and flourishing public education system that we all want to see for Cayman's young people. The first concerns the need for a comprehensive government-wide strategy for early years development. I am pleased to hear about and I support the expansion of nursery provisions that the government has spoken about. Under the last government, in September 2019, the Department of Education Services introduced a pilot nursery program for three-year-olds at Creek and Spot Bay Infant School. The evaluation of that pilot bill, as was intended, no doubt, informed the decisions the minister will make now about future provision. The focus in the pilot on the emotional and social development of young children was crucial to its success. However, this must not be left as a single initiative. It needs to be a part of a proper strategy for early years development. Such a strategy needs to address support for families, not just provide more places in schools. All available international evidence highlights the central importance of early years development to a child's subsequent learning and future achievement. We do not want to see government taking over the responsibilities of parents, but we all know that many families need help and support. Initiatives such as that announced on parental leave can play a part in the kind of strategy I envisage, Mr. Speaker. But without a comprehensive approach, the effectiveness of these one-off actions is limited. So, Mr. Speaker, I hope that the Minister and Premier will commit to this Honourable House and to the country that they will bring forward a comprehensive cross-government strategy for early years development. My second concern is about the government's plans for the delegation of responsibility for school improvement to the schools themselves, or rather, the apparent lack of such plans. I know that the last Progressives administration was committed to seeing through such a program of delegation of responsibility. There are clear benefits to be achieved in terms of freeing up schools to drive their own improvement, enhancing accountability through local governing bodies, and freeing up government itself to concentrate on driving the necessary national initiatives like the new curriculum and provision for complex special needs education. The implementation of the plans we had was delayed. First, because the minister correctly prioritized the new curriculum as priority one, and then because of COVID. However, we also know that an almost completed program had been developed by the Education Council, to which I had the honor of serving as a member, and that it was ready to be implemented. And from what I can recall, the pilot sites had also been identified. The delivery of a new governance model was mentioned in the SPS documentation, but we have heard little about it since from either the Premier or the Minister. Why not, Mr. Speaker? I hope that that commitment given to delegating power and responsibility to the schools themselves, making schools directly responsible and accountable for the success of students under their charge has not been watered down. These are important and necessary education reforms, Mr. Speaker. Can I therefore ask either the Minister or the Premier to reassure the House, what plans do they have for the implementation of new governance arrangements for public schools, and what is the timetable for action to be taken? Lastly, Mr. Speaker, I want to highlight a concern I have about the use of technology to support learning. The SPS indicated that the government would continue to invest in the rollout of technologies, giving students access to appropriate hardware in school and at home. This is another initiative of the Progressives-led administration, and I welcome its continuation. I will be looking to see that appropriate resources have been earmarked in the budget. However, my more strategic concern is different, Mr. Speaker. The introduction of technology itself is only one side of the issue as to how we can support our students to learn effectively. The point is that the technologies are a gateway to new forms of teaching and learning. They are a support to and not a substitute for high-quality teaching in the classroom. My question for the Minister is therefore, how is access to new technologies being coupled with support to both teachers and students to ensure that changes are made to classroom practice that ensure the technology is used effectively to promote better learning outcomes? Where the introduction of technologies has been successful in supporting the improvement of standards across the world, we know that it is because technology has been changing classroom practices and learning processes. Technology can be transformative in freeing the role of the teacher from being the sole deliverer of information to a more complex role of negotiating learning objectives with students, providing a tailored support for individual students, and encouraging reflection on classroom activities. Students, too, have developed vital new skills that equip them not just to succeed in education, but in the future world of work. Those skills include using technology to search for and collate information and to publish and share their findings. Mr. Speaker, these improvements do not happen just through making technology available. It takes more than that. The changes have to be planned and managed, most importantly, by supporting teachers to be able to create new learning environments. Therefore, it would be good to hear the Minister tell this Honourable House how her ministry is delivering the necessary changes beyond the delivery of hardware to schools and students. I have raised some very specific questions for the Premier and the Minister in my remarks today, Mr. Speaker. I have done so not to try to catch them out, but because I think there are key issues that they still need to be addressed. They still need to be addressed if they are to deliver the improvements we all want to see in Cayman's public schools. And by the way, Mr. Speaker, Monday gone a week ago, my colleague and good friend from Georgetown West and I, in partnership with C3, installed a very high-tech Wi-Fi system at the park in Windsor Park. Mr. Speaker, during our campaign, this is one of the promises that we made to the people of Georgetown South and Georgetown West, and I am pleased to say that it was delivered. Mrs. Speaker, having this Wi-Fi in the park will provide support for those young people and families who may not have had Wi-Fi at home to allow them to access this service to assist them with their homework or other school projects, and a service which all of the residents of Windsor Park can take advantage of. I would publicly like to thank the management of C3 and their team again for partnering with us on this most necessary service. So again, Mr. Speaker, we are encouraged by what has been said about education by the government so far. However, whatever warm words the government has to offer, we on this side and the entire country will judge them by what they do and by what they achieve. Indeed, perhaps more correctly, on what our schools and our children do and what they achieve. Cayman students deserve the best start in life that our public schools can give them. And, Mr. Speaker, another reason for me to be so passionate about the government delivering improvements in our public schools is because I have a personal interest in that my two grandchildren are in the public school system. And I want them to obtain the very best education. I want them to excel, Mr. Speaker. Let me share with you an experience I had with the public-private school system with my eldest granddaughter. She attended the primary school from inception. And when she was in her last year, that is year 6, her mother and I were a bit apprehensive about her going to the public high school. So her mother registered her into one of the private schools, Mr. Speaker. From the get-go, she was not happy. Trying to adjust from the public system to private and having to meet new friends, and the list goes on. She just would not settle. Every day was some issue or other that she came home with, including the bullying issue. Mr. Speaker, I can appreciate making that adjustment for her was difficult. She just wasn't happy. So, Mr. Speaker, she managed to make it through that year, and after much debate between her mother and I, my daughter decided to send her back to public school. And, Mr. Speaker, it was the right decision, as she is one happy girl today and is doing so well. Therefore, Mr. Speaker, that is one of the reasons I am fighting for the reform of our public schools. Cayman's public schools deserve the best support and the necessary investment that government can give them to ensure that not only do our children attend school, but that they learn. There is an expression that I once read that succinctly makes this point. Schooling without learning was not just a wasted development opportunity, but also a great injustice to children. This budget represents the opportunity for the government to spell out exactly how it plans to continue to deliver the improvements that were begun by the last progressives-led government. The country has every right to expect the PAC government to deliver continued improvements in our public schools, Mr. Speaker. I am watching and holding them to account to ensure that they do just that. Moving on, Mr. Speaker, before I end my speech on education, I want to share some exciting news. Last week, several of our news resources carried an article on two students that had won the spelling bee competitions. So I would like to take this opportunity to publicly congratulate Layla Small of Red Bay Primary for winning a top primary spot at the Education Services Primary Spelling Bee, and Alik Benjamin Bennett of John Gray for winning the top secondary spot at the 38th Lions Club of Grand Cayman Secondary Spelling Bee Championships. Mr. Speaker, despite all of the challenges that our students experience on a daily basis with this pandemic, they continue to make us proud and they continue to be resilient. So again, congrats to these two students and also to the second and third place winners. Now, Mr. Speaker, I am now moving on to social development. And this one is a bit shorter, so we can I think I can continue before lunch. Are you okay with that? Yes? Okay. This one is only a couple of pages long. This last one on social development, it's not going to take long.
I intended to call the luncheon adjournment at 1 o'clock.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
If that would be good.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Yes. Okay, on social development, Mr. Speaker. The House has heard much from this side about the track record of successful delivery of the last two governments. It is a track record we are rightly proud of. And as we have indicated, it has created a platform for future success if this new PAC government has the wisdom to capitalize upon it. However, we on this side accept that there is one issue on which the last government should have made much more progress. That issue is on the reform of social assistance. Following the critical Auditor General's report issued during the first Progressives-led government, the last administration signaled its intent to get to grips with the changes that were clearly required in order to make the system fit for purpose. The former member for Prospect, as a councillor at that time, took the lead on overseeing the necessary work on behalf of the government. What he found was that the multitude of legislation that governs the approach to social assistance in Cayman was hopelessly out of date. There was no consistency between different laws over things like eligibility criteria. For example, while some of the requirements placed on both the applicant and the staff dealing with them were unnecessarily bureaucratic and cumbersome. The start point for reform must therefore be a completely new legislative framework, Mr. Speaker. The former member for Prospect was making progress with that massive task when the pandemic struck. Unsurprisingly, all the attention of the relevant civil servants in the Needs Assessment Unit and elsewhere was rightly focused on meeting the immediate need for relief rather than on long-term reform. The work needs to be moved on, Mr. Speaker, as we find ourselves now getting clear of the crisis. I take heart from the reference in the Premier's remarks to the House that his government would be bringing forward the required legislative changes. We in the opposition will want to scrutinize the detail, but we offer our support for changes that will improve the effectiveness of the financial assistance regime. The Premier mentioned the commitment and experience that the Honourable Minister for Investment, Innovation and Social Development brings to this issue, Mr. Speaker. He was, after all, the Deputy Chief Officer of the Ministry responsible for social assistance. More importantly, his work record underlines his personal commitment to getting the best possible outcome for vulnerable Caymanian families. There's every reason to expect rapid progress now, Mr. Speaker. Much of the work has already been completed, and we have someone in charge who actually understands what needs to be done. It would be good for the minister now to tell this House and to tell the country, not just that he wants to make improvements, but that he has a plan and a timetable for bringing forth the necessary legislation. We in opposition will work with the government to make sure that the right reforms are being made and then to enact the changes as swiftly as possible. While legislative change is necessary, Mr. Speaker, as the Minister well knows, it is not sufficient. The change in legislation will then feed through into new processes and systems within the NAU and elsewhere across government. This is a real opportunity to fundamentally shift our approach and to make it work much more efficiently and effectively. When he was the Premier, When he was premier, the member for Red Bay described his government's objective as to make sure that we got the right help to the right people at the right time. The implementation of a new legislative framework is the opportunity to achieve that objective. I am sure that the minister knows all this, Mr. Speaker, but as a former civil servant himself, he will also be aware that the machinery of government has sometimes found it difficult to follow through and successfully implement change programs. That is not a criticism of our civil servants. We all know that when you have spent years doing things in a particular way, it is very difficult suddenly to switch to a different approach. Investment is required in new information technology, in process improvement, and in staff training and change management. So I ask one final question, Mr. Speaker. Can the minister reassure the House that the budget before us provides the necessary resources or the resources necessary to support the successful implementation of the legislative changes he will be bringing forward? Finally, Mr. Speaker, I wish to take this opportunity to thank my constituents of Georgetown South for their unwavering support, their encouragement, Mr. Speaker, and their love. And I pledge to continue, as I have done over the past 4 years, to serve them to the best of my ability for the duration of this term. It has certainly been a privilege and an honor for me to be their representative, Mrs. Speaker. I thank you for this opportunity.
Honorable members, we will suspend at this point, and we will return at 2:15. Before we go, the member from Bordentown, from Georgetown West, had much to say, and I want him to hear this for sake of peace of mind for you. Hate no one, no matter how much they wrong you. Live humbly, no matter how wealthy you become. Think positively, no matter how hard life is. Forgive all, especially yourself, and never stop praying for the best for everyone. The House is now suspended until 2:15. Be there.